Once more, come here and meet my longtime friend, friends of New Yorker, including Rinpoche. Oh, yeah. So, actually, I'm looking forward to this was today, a special text one Nagarjuna's wrote, one Shantideva. I have special reason feel happy because both of them, the Madhyamika philosopher, great philosopher, as well as great practitioner. Of course, Nagarjuna, usually in Sanskrit tradition, Nagarjuna considered almost like second Buddha. So, indeed, that honor, great honor. And in 21st century, at a time where quite a number of man-made problems we are facing, and especially as we are sort of facing certain problems which essentially our sort of way of thinking is actually deeper level's viewpoint unrealistic. So we consider all these events, particularly negative events or these positive events, even they say consider something absolute. So that sort of appearance acting like a basis of all destructive emotion. So these texts mainly dealing with that. So then, as usual, whenever I give some lecture on Buddhism, firstly, the recitation of Mangala Sutra in Pali. The Pali tradition is the senior most sort of Buddhist student. So please recite.
Asse bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhasse namo tasse bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhasse namo tasse bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhasse evaṃ me sutaṃ ekaṃ samayaṃ bhagavā sāvatthiyaṃ viharati jetavane anāta pindikasya ārāme athako anyatara devatā bhikkantāya rattiyā bhikkanta vannā kevala kappaṃ jetavanaṃ ubhāsetvā ena bhagavāte upasaṅkhami upasaṅkhamitvā bhagavantaṃ abhivādetvā ekamantaṃ atthāsi ekamantaṃ khitākho sā devatā bhagavantaṃ gāthāsi ආය අජ්ජ භාසී බහුදේවා මනුසාච මංගලානි අචින්තයුන් ආකංකමානා සොත්තානං රූහි මංගල මුත්තමං අසේවනාච බාලානං පණ්ඩිතානං ච සේවනා පූජාච පූජනීහානං ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං අතිරූප දේශවාසෝච පුබ්බේච කත පුඤ්ඤතාත්ථ සම් මා පනිධිච ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං බාහු සච්ඡං ච සිප්පං ච විනයෝ ච සුසික්ඛිතෝ සුභාසිතා ච යාවාචා ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං මාතා පිතූ පට්ඨානං කුත්තදාරස්ස සංඝෝ අනාකුලා ච කම්මන්තා ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං දානං ච ධම්මචරියා ච ඥාතකානං ච සංඝෝ අනව වජ්ජානි කම්මානි ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං ආරති විරති පාපා මජ්ජපානා ච සංයමෝ අප්පමාදෝ ච ධම්මේසු ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං කාරවෝ ච නිවාතෝ ච සන්තුට්ඨේ ච කතං යුතා කාලේන ධම්ම සවනං ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං කන්ති ච සෝවචස්සතා සමනානං ච දස්සනං කාලේන ධම්ම සාකච්ඡා ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං තපෝච බ්‍රහ්මචරියං ච අරිය සච්ඡාන දස්සනං නිබ්බාන සච්ච කිරියා ච ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං පුත්තස්ස ලෝක ධම්මේ චිත්තං යස්සන කම්පති අශෝකං විරජං ඛේමං ඒතං මංගල මුත්තමං ඒතාදිසානි කත්වාන සබ්බත්තමපරාජිතා සබ්බත්ත සොත්තිං ගච්ඡන්ති තං තේ සම්මංගල මුත්තමන්ති තේන සච්ච වජ්ජේන ඕතු තේ ජය මංගලං ඒතේන සච්ච වජ්ජේන ඕතු තේ ජය මංගලං ඒතේන සච්ච වජ්ජේන හෝතු තේ ජය මංගලම්
Thank you. Now in Sanskrit literature, I think the most important sutra is Panchaparamita Sutra. So there are a lot of Panchaparamita Sutra. The shorter one is this Heart Sutra. The country which traditionally follow Sanskrit tradition, they all like Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Vietnamese, and Tibetan, Mongolian recite this Heart Sutra. So the origin in Sanskrit. So therefore, now Indian bhikshu, also scholar, so please recite.
ශාස්වතම් අනේ කාර්තමනානාර්ථමනාග්මමම්මනිර්ගමම් යහ ප්‍රදත සමත්පාදං ප්‍රපංචෝපශ්මං ශිවම් දේශ්‍යාමා සම්භස්තං වන්දවදතාවරණං ප්‍රඥාපාරමිතාහෘදසූත්‍රං නමස්සර්වඥාය ආරවලුක්තේශ්වර බෝධිසත්වෝ ගම්භීරායං ප්‍රඥාපාරමිතායං චරයං චර්මාණෝ වවලෝකති ස්ම පංචස්කන්ධාහතෝ ශංසභෝ ශූන්‍යං පශ්‍යති ස්ම Eshariputta rupam shunyata shunyata varupam rupan pratak shunyata shunyata yana pratak rupam yadrupam sa shunyata ya shunyata tadrupam evme vedana sangya sanskara vijnanani Eshariputra sardharma ha shunyata lakshana anutpanna aniruddha amlana vimla nonana paripurna ha tasma shariputra shunyata yang narupam na vedana na sangyana sanskara na vijnanani na chakshu shrodrgani jiva kaya manasing न रूप शब्द गंध स्पृष्ट व धर्माः न चक्षु धातु यावन मनोधात न विद्या न विद्या न विद्याक्षयो न विद्याक्षयो यावन जरामण न जरामण क्षयो न दुख समुदय निरोध मार्ग न ज्ञान न प्राप्तिवम बोधिसत्वस्य प्रज्ञा पारमितामाश्रित विहृति चित्तावर्णः चित्तावर्ण नास्ति द्वात्रस्तो विपर्यासाति क्रांतो निष्णर्वाणः त्रयोदयवसुताः सर्वबुद्धाः प्रज्ञा पारमितामाश्रित अनुत्तरांग सम्यक् संबोधि अभिसंबुधाः तस्मा जज्ञातव्य प्रज्ञा पारमिता महामंत्रो महाविद्या मंत्रो अनुत्तर मंत्रो असमसम मंत्र सर्व दुख प्रशमन सत्यमित्तत्वात् प्रज्ञा पारमितायां मुक्तो मंत्र तदता गदे गदे पार गदे पार संगते बोधि स्वाहा गदे गदे पार गदे पार संगते बोधि स्वाहा गदे गदे पार गदे पार संगते बोधि स्वाहा यदि प्रज्ञा पारमिता हृदय सूत्रं समाप्तम् प्रज्ञा पारमितां बोधो शुभरत्नाकर स्वयं सर्व पारमितास्तत्र तदात्मनं भवस्थिताः निष्प्रपञ्चा निराभाषा निर्विकल्पा निरालया निःस्वभाव परासूक्ष्मा बिन्दुनादु विवर्जिता प्रज्ञा पारमितां माता सर्वबुद्धोदया परा त्र्याणुपलब्धिरूपा सर्वज्ञानगोचरा निरालम्बा पदे प्रज्ञा निरालम्बा महाकृपा एकी भूताः धेया साधर्म गगने गगनम यथा
थैंक यू नाउ टिबेटन आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू रिसाइट थ्रू द होल बट आई वांट टू रिसाइट द मंत्रा ऑफ Panjaparamita Sutra. Masam jemi shira pare jem ma jemi ga na ge ngo ni so so ra re yi shi shi ma tu sum ke ve yung la sa se lo. Teya da ga de ga de para ga de para sam ga de bu de ye sa. Teya da ga de ga de para ga de para sam ga de bu de ye sa. Teya da ga de ga de para ga de para sam ga de bu de ye sa. The praising the highest ultimate wisdom is composed by Maitreya Buddha. Now, praising to Buddha, because Buddha taught the Asita, the emptiness through explanation of interdependency. So there's Patitasamubandha. So that compose is made by Nagarjuna. One of his main texts that called Madhyamika Mulakarika, and the 27 chapters. It's, I think, top most important text about Shunyata. So he recite that. Kangi denjin zhe wan zhu, kakpa me ba, jim me ba, chepa me ba, dang me ba, wang me ba, zhu me ba, tate temi denjin, drepa ni shi shi den ba, zhobe san jie man nam jie, tamba de la cha zhe lo. Now, how to start now? Perhaps now, 6 billion human beings and also infinite sentient beings who have this feeling of self, I. Although very difficult to identify the self or I, there's a lot of controversy about self, the nature of this existence of the self. Even within Buddhism, there are a lot of sort of different views. But it doesn't matter. You see, everybody, every sentient being, is a feel self, I. That's the topmost sort of, I said, the precious. And with that, the feeling or experience of pains and pleasure and sadness, anxiety, all these different sort of emotions, different feelings there, different experiences there. So because of these different sort of experiences, then by nature, there's a strong desire to achieve joyfulness, happiness, and desire to overcome all these negative sort of experiences. No need to reason, no need to prove. It's there. That also the basis of fundamental right, because we have that feeling, and we have every right to overcome these problems. There's a fundamental right. These are the basis of fundamental right. So we, human beings, we have this intelligence. What is the purpose of that intelligence? You see, we don't know, but intelligence is there. A wonderful brain is there. Now it is wise to use that sophisticated intelligence to bring more happiness, more joyfulness. It is right. It is rather pity. This very sophisticated intelligence bring more anxiety, more worry, more sort of, what's it, almost like self-torture. No use. It is silly. So therefore, this is certain sort of, what's the way of thinking is a key factor to bring more happy life or more miserable life. So external matters, money, power, fame, these also we love or we like. These also basically a facility or factor to bring some satisfaction. But these are secondary, because compare mind, physical, mind is superior. The reason is simple. Too much worry, too much pain on mental level, physical comfort cannot subdue that. Clear. On the other hand, physical pain can subdue or can ignore by mental sort of state of peace or some satisfaction. Even some cases, the pain voluntarily take in order to achieve the satisfaction, deeper satisfaction on mental level. It happens. So therefore, the mental experience is superior than the physical. So then logically, matters or the material facilities simply provide comfortable for this physical, not mind. So therefore, the mental levels of comfort mainly come from mental level itself. So right view, right thinking brings mental strength. Mental strength brings mental calmness. That brings happiness, joyfulness, because the mental so calm state reduces fear, anxiety, too much stress, like that. So in human history, the concept of religion then come. Religion, I think, broadly speaking, perhaps religion is a sort of a way of thinking to bring hope and self-confidence. And that way, lead right kind of sort of life. I think we may say that way. So within that religion, now broadly speaking, within that religion, there are many different, mainly two groups. One group, the fundamental sort of faith or concept is creator, God, or Allah, or like that, or Brahman. Brahma, like that. The other group, things happen due to law of causality. No creator. The causality itself creates these new things, and the new things create another new thing. That's something like evolution. So that belief, that view, carried by Buddhism and Jainism, and also one ancient Indian non-Buddhist school of thought, that is Sangha philosophy, is believed that way, law of causality. So these two are major two divisions. So both take care about spirituality or deeper human values. Clear? Like that. So basically, the things which bring inner peace, inner satisfaction, or inner calmness, that we may call moral ethics. So there are, we can say, three ways of the way of promotion, three ways of promotion.
Promoting
moral ethics. One, the theistic religion, monotheistic religion. And the second, those religion, sometimes we refer non-theistic. I don't know the exact meaning, I don't know, but in any way, that's another one. Then according to reality, there should be third one. That is as a secular way, not based on religious faith, but simply using our common sense, common experience, and more important, the latest scientific finding. Based on these facts, then develop conviction. Moral ethics are a key factor for meaningful life, even good health. So that should be so that. And that, I mean, it is, I think, according to the reality, we need that kind of way of approach. Because there are a large number, out of 6 billion human beings, I think quite a big proportion of that 6 billion human beings not much serious about religion. Even some against religion. So therefore, if these people, because they have no interest about religion, so they also no interest about practice of compassion or these things. And even they, some of them, you see, feel moral ethics is something just extra burden. Discipline, sometimes you feel something, imposing something. No, actually, discipline, self-discipline, we always say self-discipline. That means, now for example, the doctor, according to your physical condition or illness, you should take this kind of food more, you should take more exercise, like that kind of sort of advice. So for our own, for the patient's own sort of benefit, you see, there is some sort of, what's it, Langdor, correct?
Some behavior, conduct, according to that.
So out of one's own interest, I should not do this because this is long-term, very harmful for me. I should do this because it helped me. So on the awareness of that, for our own interest, then you see, restrain some wrongdoing. That is self-discipline. So some people, you see, they better, you see, they complete sort of freedom, whatever you like. Even if you want to die, well, let me die. If you want to jump, let jump. That kind of say is not the sort of the right. You see, self-discipline is important. Now, self-discipline will not bring by religious faith because these people no faith. So then, these people also want a happy life or successful life. So the very successful life is very much dependent on their mental state and good health. So in this field, a certain sort of way of thinking, certain sort of behavior is very much relevant. Once that clear, then these people, non-believers also, then showing some interest. Now some scientists, now actually, is in doing more research in this field. So they already now last, I think, nearly maybe 10 years, you see, already they found this is certain mental thinking. It's immense benefit for our physical health. So now sometimes they call healthy body, healthy mind. So it's quite very, very interesting. So now, as the secular way to approach these things, this time, any occasion, public talk? No, no public talk. Your way. Oh, then okay. And public talk, I will go more detail. This field, that field. Now today, mainly the religious matter. Now here I want to make clear the world last almost, I think, 3,000, or some cases maybe 4,000 years. Different religious traditions eventually how should they develop in different location, different period. Then people at that sort of area, you see, eventually, how should they follow that religion, that brings immense benefit. So in the West, basically a non-Buddhist country. Your background, your religious sort of faith, traditionally, mainly Judeo-Christian, or Sede faith, and to some extent Islam also. Buddhism and Jainism and Hinduism this, and also Taoism this belongs to East. Now, in modern time, because of a lot of contact and also information, so naturally, among the millions of people, some people have some special keen interest about different traditions. So in the West, in recent decades, some people really showing interest about Eastern philosophy, Eastern thought. And there are a number of sort of Zen centers, and also some the Hindus, who say the practitioner also is there. Some English sadhaji looks a little bit strange. That we found like that, English or rather, Western one.
Western.
Like that. So so that's today's world. In the East also, a large number of Christians, Muslims, had a follower of Judaism, not many. But like that. So sometimes I really admire the India sort of the situation. Not only today, but it's 1,000 years. Beside different religion, which homegrown, that is the Brahmanism, Brahmanism, and Buddhism, and then Jainism, and then later Sikhism, these homegrown religion. Beside that, Judaism, Zoroastrianism from Iran, ancient Iran, the small community Parsi in Bombay area mainly, is it is Zoroastrian sort of religion, come from outside. Then also large number of Muslim. Now, in fact, India is the greatest number of Muslim.
After Indonesia.
After Indonesia, like that. So very, so all these, I say the, almost I think whole world's major religious tradition exists in India. So that also, so I think 1,000 years, India remain like multi-religious sort of continent. So that one advantage is, since the, every Indian children, from their childhood, different sort of temples, different sort of was prayers, different chantings, you see, for granted, there are. So the pluralistic sort of idea from the childhood there. So that I always say, telling the people, you know, that should be model. Of course, now West is a non-Buddhist or is it mainly Judeo Christian sort of background, but in the meantime, now it's a large number of Asians, Chinese, Vietnamese, Cambodians, and Japanese, and as well as the many people from India and from Arabs, Africa, like that. So therefore, like that. So therefore, there are people who follow different tradition. But here, you see, whether we like it or not, already become like that, multi-religious sort of community. Then we have to make some effort to bring genuine harmony. Otherwise, it may cause conflict. So India is the model, I think, the rest of the world. So therefore, I I always describe myself as a messenger of ancient Indian thought, messenger of nonviolence. This is mainly India's tradition. In my case, the nonviolence on the level of action, that action, nonviolent action, must based on, I mean, nonviolent action comes from nonviolent emotion. That is compassion. So nonviolence is, I think, the action level. The compassion is motivation level. So we can say nonviolence is the act of compassion. Just to restrain humming, that's not necessarily nonviolence. You see, there is possibility or chance of involvement of violence, but deliberately restrain violence. That's nonviolence. So therefore, my number one commitment is promotion of nonviolence or compassion. That also I consider basic human value. Then second, the religious understanding or harmony among different religious traditions on the basis of mutual understanding or mutual respect. So in non-Buddhist country, a lecture on Buddhism by a Buddhist monk looks strange. But because of these sort of the background, so it may be useful. Like that. So meantime, whenever I give some lecture on Buddhism, I always made clear, you Westerners or people follow Islam or follow Judaism or follow Christian, better to keep your own tradition. Sometimes you see people, you see, fond, change new things, including sort of dress, fashion survey. So don't do that way in the religious field. It is better to keep one's own traditional religion. It's much safer. I always sort of refer one story. I think many of you already know. So then you may feel this is too much repetition, but some of you may not. So one story in early 60, so when is a Tibetan refugee who newly arrived from Tibet, or immediately after 59, sort of was the cross through India, there's a lot of problem, a lot of suffering. So at that time, one family, actually one Tibetan government official, lay official, before 1959. So he posted in border area. Therefore, his advantage is he brought with his family from central Tibet, only those male physical strong, only that type. He brought with his wife, I think two, three children, young children. So eventually, the husband passed away. Then poor mother, with those small children, left under difficult circumstances. Then at that time, of course, besides the government of India, and also some, I think, the committee set up by an American Fletcher or something, the emergency sort of committee to take care about the refugee, Tibetan refugee. Beside that, main feeder of Tibetan community at that time, Catholic Relief Service, all these things, So many missionaries really came to help us. They also, you see, carry some missionary work. So the missionary, sort of missionary, some missionary, you see, take full care about that family. So one day, I think maybe 63, 64, maybe like that. One day, one old lady came to see me, and with crying, with tear, explained about her sort of fate, difficulties. Then she mentioned to me, now some missionary sort of people take care, not only her life, but also her children's education. She very much sort of appreciate all their help. So then she told me, now for this life, now she become Christian. But next life, she will be Buddhist. So this is the clear sign of confusion. And also similarly, some Westerners, in 1956, I noticed some nun, I think French or something, so wear Tibetan Buddhist monk's robe. I noticed in 56. And after 59, I inquire about that English Buddhist nun. Then someone told me, now she again become Christian and very critical about Buddhism. So these are the sort of some example. So therefore, it is much better to keep one's own tradition. Meantime, you can take some sort of practice or certain sort of method or certain technique. For example, single-pointed meditation, and also certain sort of method to promote forgiveness or tolerance and compassion, these things. Like we Tibetan Buddhists also, you see, they take some experience from Christian brothers, sisters, very useful, particularly in the field of education and health. In fact, I think on this planet, I think Christianity, I think made maximum contribution for education everywhere. Mare, I think among the religious group, I think Christianity, Christians, I think topmost sort of contributor for education. Look, Africa, Asia, Latin America, everywhere. In Arab area, still, I think still limited like that. So therefore, it is better to keep one's own tradition. Then those individuals who really years, you see, felt Buddhist way of approach is most effective, most suitable to oneself. In such case, okay, let's follow Buddhism. It's as an individual freedom. But meantime, it is very, very important to keep genuine respect to other tradition, particularly your traditional religion. It is very, very essential. Very essential. Like that, with I myself, sometimes I describe staunch Buddhist. That means I study all those, some sort of important text, which critically analyze the false or contradiction of non-Buddhist tradition. now including this in Nagarjuna's now text I'm going to read, and then also the Shandadevas of the book, a lot of critical sort of analyzation which finds contradiction in other tradition. So therefore, from the Buddhist viewpoint, as we feel some contradictions, but knowing, so therefore I describe staunch Buddhist, not just as a follow faith. But at the same time, you say, I have deep admiration, deep sort of respect to all tradition, like that. So when I visit when I take some kind of pilgrimage, they sit to different sort of holy places, like mosque, or church, or synagogue, like that. So I truly feel deep admiration and appreciation. This tradition brings immense benefit to millions of people. One time in Lourdes in France, I went as a pilgrimage. The Mary statue, and in front on some water is there. I was told some sick people drinking that water is even cure. So I spent a few moments in the front of that statue and have the feeling, oh, this provides new hope, new life to hundreds of people, thousand people. Like that. So therefore, it is not difficulties. It is not sort of impossible. Being, keep strong faith, one's own tradition, but meantime, genuine respect and admiration and appreciation to other traditions. That can be done. So, I want to make clear that, because in the text, some criticisms about some other sort of non-Buddhist tradition philosophy is mentioned. So don't worry that. And then that's, you see, within Buddhist, the Buddhist tradition, particularly in Nalanda, the monastic institution, through generations, this argument within Buddhist sort of master, a lot of sort of criticism, the other sort of viewpoint. It is quite normal. Like that. So, now, text.